Ya estoy en línea con el compañero Volkan desde Ankara, Turquía. Con él vamos a hablar de la situación que está pasando su país, pero también de la situación más global de Medio Oriente. Hola, Volkan. Gracias por estar con nosotros. Te quería preguntar, en primer lugar, ¿cuál es la situación social y política que está atravesando Turquía? ¿Nos podés contar un poquito cuál es la situación de tu país?
Yes, first I should start with the pandemic because it is getting intense day by day in Turkey because after the restrictions loosened, the pandemic is re-escalated and the health system is coming to its limits. So in the coming future of some weeks maybe, the hospitals can reach its limits, we think. Of course, the workers, working class in Turkey, in the factories, the real burden is paid by the working class. In some factories, for example, some the biggest factories, there are some hundreds of workers capturing this illness. So the conditions are especially very bad for the workers. And besides, other than the pandemic, there's an economic crisis and the people is now experiencing a rapid impoverishment due to the economic crisis, which is already come to Turkey before the pandemic, and the pandemic make it deeper. Turkish lira lost its value around 30%. When we compare to last year, and we can say that the objective conditions for a social explosion is getting mature like the other countries in the world. But the only thing that will prevent the possible social explosion in Turkey is the cultural polarization around Erdogan himself, because he always constantly fuels this polarization. I mean, with cultural polarization is on the one side seculars and on the other side conservatives. On the one side the Kurdish, on the other side the Turkish. And on the one side the Sunnis and on the other side Alevis. So Erdogan always fuels these distinctions and make the society polarize according to these identities. So in his voting base always very strong for the deteriorating conditions. So although there's a huge crisis, the breaking from the ruling party, AKP, is relatively slow. But there's a clear tendencies for the ruling party and his partner, the fascist MHP, the fascist party, their support is going to lose, but not a rapid way, but slow way. The reason is this polarization, because everybody thinks that, okay, this is our man, so all the other, there's economic crisis, we should support him. One thing about the opposition, the bourgeois opposition, these parties are very hopeful for the next presidential election, and they also make the opposition people to wait these elections, because last year there was a municipal local elections. And in these local elections, the ruling party, the Erdogan's and this fascist party, lost the elections very clearly. They lost most of the important states, including Istanbul and Ankara. So bourgeois opposition thinks that we will have a common candidate in the elections, so we will win the elections. But we know that the dynamics of the presidential elections is very different than the municipal elections. So. And one thing also, it is very uncertain that Erdogan will accept the results. Everybody has some doubts about this. Other than the bourgeois opposition's class character, their policy is very neoliberal and very pro-Western. These parties consist of many different origins. For example, the secular CHP to Kurdish HDP to split from the fascist party. There's a nationalist party, but they are in opposition, and also some Islamist, small Islamist groups, which has common origin with Erdogan. These all parties are now try to unite in a bloc to stop Erdogan dictatorship. And this bourgeois opposition minimize opposition in the streets. Also, I should say that in Turkey, there's a huge police repression to the streets, huge state repression over the Kurdish people, Kurdish opposition, and over socialist opposition. And what is important is that socialists, unfortunately, don't have the class perspective necessary to overcome these different conditions. They are mainly, most of them are mainly in the tails of the Kurdish nationalism, Kurdish party. Of course, there are leftist party, but they have some important links with the neoliberal European Union and the big business. So it's like the socialists who support them is like a popular front. And the other side of, for example, the Stalinist Turkish Communist Party has a Kemalist orientation. So they are very sectarian, and their policy is also in the lines of the cultural polarization. So our party, SEP, didn't remain idle during the pandemic process. We are continuing our organizational work, party work, in the working class areas and in the industrial centers. So our class orientation and our party work non-stop is very different, very energetic and very dynamic in the socialist left. And so for many people, we are the hope for the future. I can say that we get the results of our work and made important progress in these struggles. And as a party, we are hopeful about ourselves and the future of this country, Turkey, because Kurdish and Turkish workers have a very good tradition for struggle. So if we take this tradition and the energy of the people, the youth and the workers and the women, to put the socialist politics, I think we will have chance in the future for leading the left of the left in Turkey, socialist left, the socialist party, socialist revolutionary party. We will have chance for changing the balance of the classes and changing the politics, how to do politics. We are hopeful about the coming future, and we are ready to make fight against the dictatorship.
¿Puedes explicar cuáles son las razones del conflicto de Turquía con Grecia y cuál es tu posición?
Turkey and Greece have a long history of tension, the nationalist war and struggles, and always some provocations. The main issue is always about the sovereignty conflicts in the Aegean Sea and the Cyprus, over Cyprus. All the time, bourgeois governments on the both sides have always raised nationalism and used this in the internal politics. This time, which is new, is that the natural gas resources in the Eastern Mediterranean Sea trigger or exacerbated the issue. So Erdogan government, the ruling party in Turkey, which has a very aggressive foreign policy against everyone, made a lot of enemies, and they lost their allies, such as Israel and everyone. Such as Syria and Egypt. So in the sharing table in the Eastern Mediterranean Sea, around national gas, they excluded from the table, the sharing table. And this, of course, increases the possibility of the war and increases the possibility of the conflicts in the Eastern Mediterranean. And of course, this is related with the Libya issue, the conflict in Greece and the conflict over Cyprus and Eastern Mediterranean and even Syria to Libya. These all have some links with each other. But the main issue is searching of the natural gas over the sea and the boundaries. What are the boundaries? The problem is this. Everybody wants more, and Erdogan sent some armed ships, the navy, with in very big amount of navy to the sea to and make many provocations. So you have to accept this. Otherwise, we are ready to fight, ready to war, and you will be the. They make pressure over the Greece because Greece is a small country when we compare it to Turkey. So they say you will be lonely, the France or others will not fight for you. So you have to accept our demands. So the conflict is getting very dangerous. It is said that it was very near to war, but we know that these conflicts are always, they know the limits. But what is dangerous is that the time these times in the world is very, very dangerous times because making balance is not very easy many times. So Erdogan is desperately needs such kind of war that he will win. But of course, there is always the risk for loss and for disaster. So Erdogan for now didn't take this risk and they step back. This time it is not very different, but the one who have to make an attempt is Greece, because the Turkish Navy is violating Greek determination. So Greece has to do something, but they will not, they cannot, because Turkish army is strong. So, but they will, this kind of conflict is, I think it will continue, but it is very dangerous if there is an important accident or a provocation that will trigger the war. So our position is always with the Greek comrades is international, of course. We are, although, of course, the bourgeoisie is always very nationalist too, but we don't, of course, emphasize over the Greek nationalism, but we should concentrate on Turkish nationalism, and we should concentrate our fight against the Turkish government. And it is not only the Erdogan issue, because the Kemalists also are very, very aggressive. And we know that the Greek communists and real socialists do the same. They will concentrate on the Greek bourgeoisie. So our duty is confronting the sub-imperialist interventions of the Turkish state over Syria, over Libya, and over Mediterranean, Eastern Mediterranean, or the Cyprus and Greece. So we are international revolutionary, and we, of course, Erdogan needs this kind of tensions to use these external tensions to reduce economic problems, troubles from the agenda of people. Yes, our work is always internationalism, and this say us that the real enemy is first at home, then we look to, of course, the world. We are now fighting with this sub-imperialist aggressiveness.
¿Qué impresión tenés sobre la situación más global de Medio Oriente? En particular de los países que han protagonizado procesos importantes de movilización durante el año pasado y este. ¿Qué nos puedes decir de lo que está pasando allí?
It is obvious that the youth and the workers in the Middle East want a different life. They want jobs, they want good life, democracy, they want human rights. But the reality is that the system, the capitalist system and imperialist system cannot give this kind of elementary human wishes and the future for the youth. Even in the Western liberal parliamentary system, the bourgeois democracy change to dictatorships. When we look at, for example, Bolsonaro, Trump, and the Modi in India and in Turkey, Erdogan, and it's going like this. So the democratic perspective, the problem is in the Middle East for the struggle, for the uprisings, is the socialist perspective. We understand this, but we try to change this. We establish contacts with the socialist elements inside the movements and discuss the program. Because without socialist perspective, there is no democracy. There will be no good life. There will be no jobs and human rights. The system is very weak and they cannot give anything. We have to discuss this. And to reach these elementary and basic rights, we have to get the socialism and we have to establish the socialist workers' government. And when we look at the dynamics in Iran, in Iraq, and in Lebanon, that last year there was uprisings, they are the centers and they are focus of the revolutionary upheavals in the region. And of course, you comrades, Alejandro, will discuss the Lebanon issue, the Lebanese comrades, but I can speak some kind of some sentences with the Iraq and Iran. In these countries, the dynamics are still alive. The pandemic make a break in the struggles in the streets. So the enemies of the people use this as an opportunity to make people forget their struggles, rechange the balance of forces. For example, in Iraq, we see that there are some extrajudicial assassinations of the activists in the struggles. For example, in Basra, in the south, which is the second important city in Iraq, when we compare with the Mosul, other than Baghdad, this city is a center of Shia community, and there is also this is the center of the popular uprisings with Baghdad, and some militias with the Iranian help, they assassinate the vanguard of the social movements. Because we see that in Iraq there is an imperialist competition between Iran and USA. The problem again is that the Iranian militias, although they don't have much support from the people, they have guns, they have militias. So they attack people, they kill people because people want a free country from both the USA and from both Iran. Iran has very important, a very big hand over Iraq. So the people criticize this Iranian effects and the Iranians now killing people in the streets. It is very dangerous. And they slander to social movement as a pro-Western. Of course, it is not a homogeneous social upheaval, social struggle, but especially the vanguard is not only they are against Iran, but also they are against USA. But we see that USA is trying to control the movement or to control the government. So there is a big fight over Iraq, and the people are seduced with these forces. So we have, of course, comrades in Iraq, and Workers Against Sectarianism group is very brave and vanguard, one of the vanguard groups. We are discussing these programmatic issues with them, because other than permanent revolution and social struggles and working class organizations, there is no real way out these conflicts. We will see, because of the pandemic, when the conditions are okay for the struggles in the streets, we will see, because the vanguards in Basra, for example, 7 people has killed in the last month. We will see this can, I think they cannot make people afraid from this kind of assassinations. And our comrades is very important. Workers Against Sectarianism is very important, because they can lead a struggle such this, a very dangerous country. And so they have to organize in this kind, I think they have to organize in these conditions. They make necessary organizational apparatus for struggling this kind of assassinations. They should organize according to these conditions. We are discussing this with comrades. In Iran, of course, very different country. Everybody, nearly all, most of the people in the country hates the Islamist rule. But of course, even kill people in Iraq, think they, what can they do in the Iran itself. So the people are very brave, and the people are very poor, and factories and teachers, especially in the south of the, Iran, the sugar mill company, they are the vanguard of the working class and poor people. And we see that this time in Iran, the poor people are on front, not the middle class, secular middle class in Tehran, upper, the good neighborhoods, but the peripheral parts, rural parts. And of course, the working class are on the front, and people don't afraid. Thousands of them killed in the previous uprising in the recent years. So we expect both countries a new social explosions. Of course, this, the real problem is the organization, the socialist organization, socialist revolution organization. But there are elements. The Iranian community is always have a tendency to the leftism, but organizationally, unfortunately, this is not the case. But Iraq conditions are not such harsh to organize as Iran, but we expect again revolutions in these two countries. And of course, the North Africa, we don't say the we cannot explain every country, but after the pandemic will pass, the class war is getting more and more radical, and we expect social explosions, and we hope we will win the groups and the individuals to Marxist revolution, Marxism, and we will fight with them for socialist Middle East Federation.
¿Quisieras agregar algo más?
Yes, red salutes from Turkey to everyone. And we, of course, it is very clear that we have to organize the ISL. We have to make it bigger. We have to reach the working class and recruit new cadres, educate new cadres, and join every fight. And we have to win the vanguard of the masses and vanguard of the working class. So we have very deep respect to everyone who is fighting for this goal.
Muchas gracias, Volcán. Seguimos en contacto.